That's Dr. Jim Chappius. I'm the founder and CEO of Spine Center Atlanta. I'm a board certified orthopedic spine surgeon in practice for over 30 years in Atlanta. This video today is to help explain the syndrome of failed back surgery. It's a term that's in the literature, but really what it means is patients who have had previous back surgery, spinal surgery, and are still in pain. And so that's what we want to discuss today, what this is, what causes it, and what are the solutions to help patients that have this problem. So there's a number of causes for failed spine surgery, and it doesn't always involve bad surgical outcomes. So many times there's many different sources for pain. We call those pain generators. And to have a successful operation as a spine surgeon, we need to identify all of the major pain generators and address those at the time of surgery, because if one or more of those are left behind, then there's a good possibility you can still have pain. Other causes are operating only on one level when there are multiple levels involved. There's also problems with the instrumentation, in particular pedicle screws. Are they malpositioned? Has the fusion actually healed? And many times when that happens, if screws aren't loose, they will become loose and they can then cause pain also. Another source for pain can be a pseudoarthrosis, which really means if you've had back fusion or a lumbar fusion, that the fusion actually didn't heal, or as some people say, it just didn't take. And not all pseudoarthroses are painful, but if you have persistent back pain after a spinal fusion, then it's time to look at what are the potential causes for that. And it can be the fusion didn't take, it could be the screws have loosened, it could be the screws are malpositioned. So any of those can be problematic if you have back pain after the operation. Now, if you have leg pain, then we need to look at the actual neural foramen where your nerve roots come out. Has that been adequately decompressed, or have we adequately taken the pressure off the nerve? Sometimes the pedicle screws can be malpositioned to where they could actually be touching or irritating a nerve root. And then finally, there's always a possibility that a level, again, above where or below where the fusion was done could actually be causing compression of a nerve root. So the way we would determine that would, first of all, I would want to see what's called a CT scan. And a CT scan is best when instrumentation is placed in the spine, because an MRI scan causes scatter anytime there's metal. So a CT scan is going to help us determine if your fusion's solid and the placement of your pedicle screws. Now, sometimes if there's leg pain also, we want to add dye in your spinal sac, and that's called a myelogram. And once the dye is injected in the spinal sac, mostly by a radiologist, then a CT scan is done afterwards, and that gives us the best look at the neural foramen or the opening where the nerves come through. So once those tests are done, then we usually evaluate our patients and see if we can determine exactly where the pain generator is and what's going on with the fusion and the screw placement. So now that we've talked about that, what are the symptoms that a patient might experience after spinal surgery that would indicate there's problems? Well, obviously pain. If you have pain after the surgery, there's going to be a certain period of time pain is going to be present just from the surgery itself. But one of the big indicators is if you have pain on the contralateral leg. For instance, you went into surgery with right leg pain and you wake up with left leg pain. There's something going on there, because obviously you didn't have those symptoms prior to surgery. If you have symptoms in the same leg that surgery was performed on, it could just be that the nerve root's recovering. But still, if there's pain there, then that's something for your surgeon to watch and see if it improves. If not, then I think we'd want to look at some of the tests we mentioned earlier. Now, I know most people are familiar with MRI scans. We still do those. Problem with MRI scans, if there's metal spinal instrumentation in, you can have scatter, which makes it difficult to identify screw placement and fusion. And that's why a CT scan is something that we like to get along with an MRI scan. So once you've had surgery, you're still in pain, you've had time to recover from the actual operative procedure, you've got scans which show there's a problem, then what's the next step? Well, first we'd want to try conservative care. We'd want to have you see our interventional spine specialist, Dr. Adams, and we'd want to try some injections such as an epidural block, selective nerve root block, things like this to try to help calm the pain down. Once all those are done and you're still in pain, then the question is it from a pseudoarthrosis or your fusion didn't take? If that's the case, then a revision operation is in order. Now, if you had the operation done from the back with pedicle screws and your fusion didn't heal with whatever inner body device was put in, and that could be done through what's called a T-lift procedure, a P-lift procedure, or a lateral X-lift procedure. Each of those procedures puts an inner body device between the vertebrae and then pedicle screws are put in from the back. So in that case, if the fusion isn't solid, what we like to do is go from the front or anteriorly, remove the cage that didn't heal and do an anterior lumbar inner body fusion. The success rate for those are very high. The fusion rate is very successful. Most of the time we would leave the pedicle screws in until the fusion's solid. At that point, if you're still having pain, then we'd want to evaluate as to whether or not the pedicle screws were giving you pain. Again, that's done with a CT scan where we can evaluate the screw placement. The other thing that I do if patients are still painful and there's on physical exam, there's tenderness over the screws, I'll ask Dr. Adams, our interventional spine physician, to inject local anesthetic under C-arm guidance in the operating room around the screws, get the patient up to walk to see if that relieves their symptoms. If it does, you've got a solid fusion where we revise the pseudoarthrosis, then we would recommend having your screws removed. During surgery at our center, we use intraoperative spinal cord monitoring. Now, we're not the only facility that does this. There's a number of facilities that use this. I would consider this to be standard of care. So if you're about to have spinal surgery, the question you can ask your surgeon is, do you use intraoperative spinal cord monitoring? That consists of intraoperative EMG monitoring, which monitors each of the nerve roots in the area where you're going to have surgery. It can also involve SSEP monitoring, which is somatosensory evoked potentials. That's probably not something that would be used in your lumbar spine. That's a monitoring technique that would be used in cervical spine or thoracic spine surgery. The last would be motor evoked potentials. And that monitors your anterior spinal column or anterior spinal cord. Again, not necessarily something you'd use in lumbar surgery, but something you would want to consider for cervical or thoracic spine surgery. The last point I'd like to comment on is today, there's a number of us that do our spine surgery in an outpatient setting. It's still done inpatient, but there are a number of facilities that are doing their procedures in an outpatient setting. What we like about the outpatient setting is that we have the same team every time. I've got the same scrub tech. I've got the same first assist. We've got the same circulating nurse. We also have a much lower incidence of post-operative infections because we don't have all the nosocomial infections that a number of hospitals have. So it's still standard of care for surgery to be done in an in-hospital setting, but it's also standard of care now for these procedures to be done in an outpatient setting.